Welcome everybody to today's broadcast here at Echo Church. We are so excited that you made it here today. My name is Steven, two-time intramural college quarterback and middle school class treasurer.
And I'm California State champion wide receiver for the Ultimate Frisbee team of San Jose State University. Tim Castagna, so glad to have you here with us today. It's gonna be a great day.
Man, I am so excited for this season's kickoff. I mean, our series kickoff of Relationship Playbook, and it coincides with the NFL season, so I know there's many of you that are really excited. Now, since we've gotten into the coronavirus season, our viewers and fans have been able to be a lot more interactive during these type of events. Tim, what's the best play for them to do today?
Yeah, even though we can't fill our stadiums, there's some really key things that you can do, so make sure that you cheer, high five, send some fist bump emojis right there in the chat, but most importantly, you're gonna wanna make sure to check in. Now, if you're brand new to this experience here at Echo Church Live, make sure you do so, especially if you're new, because we're gonna send you a $10 gift card just as a way of saying thank you and cheering you on for the game today. So I know there's been a lot of anticipation for what's gonna be happening today, a lot of preparation that's gone into it. So Steven, what should we be expecting today?
Man, I think the game plan from both sides is gonna be really strong today. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna get started with our national anthem. I mean, our worship team's gonna come up and start us off with some music. Then Pastor Andy, he has an amazing game plan on how to tackle relationships we're gonna walk into. And then after that, we're gonna do a little post-game analysis right back here with all of you. Well, let's go ahead and get ready for kickoff. Billy, back to you. Man, I'm really excited to see what that first point is gonna be.
Great things, have done great things. Oh, hero, break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken to life. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great.
The promise, you'll bury body. worship you today, Lord. We're grateful for who you are. We're grateful that you didn't stay dead in that grave, but that you rose so that we could have hope in you. We worship you today, Jesus. All honor, all the glory, all the power to you forever and ever, Jesus. We pray that you would speak to each and every person today listening. We thank you so much for who you are. And it's your name we pray. Amen.
Hey everybody, we are so glad that you're here with us today. I want to say a warm welcome to those of you who are joining us for the first time. We're so glad that you're here with us. In fact, we would love to know that you're here. There's a button that's about to click up. It's the check-in button. And we would love to get to know you. We have a gift that we would love to send to you just as our way of saying thank you for being here with us. Perhaps maybe even you had a friend that invited you or you received a mailer. It's so awesome to know that there are people every single week who are joining us for the first time. And there are some of you who invited a friend. I want to say way to go. I'm proud of you for doing that. And then if you're part of the Echo family, let us know that you're with us. Let us know how you're doing. Click on the check-in button. Let us know how we can be praying for you. It's so important to stay connected during this crazy time. Again, if this is your first time and we've never had a chance to meet, my name is Andy. I'm the lead pastor here at Echo. Today, we're kicking off a new series. It's called Relationship Playbook. This series reminds me of high school for one particular reason. When I was a junior in high school, we got a new football coach. Now, this is really important because my first year of high school, we were horrible. Our football team was 0-9. We got destroyed every game. In fact, many of the guys on my football team thought it was funny that we would lose. If you know me, you know I'm an insanely competitive person. I hate to lose. So sometimes when we get on the bus after the game and everybody's laughing and we had lost by 45 points, I would get so mad. There was at least one time I threw my helmet. I was so mad, and I'm not proud of it. But when Coach Bechtel came to the Farmington Falcons in 1997, things began to change. And one thing that changed was the standard. He started calling practice to start on time. He gave us all of these values and rules that we were supposed to uphold. And all of the guys on my team, they started playing differently. We went from 0-9 to 2-7 to 6-4 to then 7-3. Then eventually they went all the way deep into the playoffs. That was after I left. Maybe that was the reason they got better. But it changed because of Coach Bechtel. It changed because of a playbook. The playbook that he put into our hands had values, had principles of how to play football. There were all these plays that we would call. We even knew how to call audibles. This was like a total game changer for us simply because one person put in place some standards of how to relate and play together. Now, isn't it crazy to think about the concept of a playbook and how all of us would love a playbook for every different aspect of our lives? I love this definition of a playbook from online. It says a playbook is a book containing plays and strategies. Wouldn't you love it if somebody just gave you a playbook for relationships? In fact, if that playbook, I know that there are like different movies like this where you could get inside the mind of somebody else to know what they're thinking. Perhaps students, if you could like see what's inside your teacher's mind on the other side of that Zoom call, that would be awesome. Well, I don't have that kind of a playbook. But this whole series is about helping you succeed in your relationships. In fact, we're going to recognize through the series that you're going to need, and I need, different strategies for different relationships. You're relating to parents if you're a student. You're relating to your kids if you're a parent. We're relating to teachers or our students if you're a teacher. We're relating to classmates, coworkers, all different types of people. And many times, part of the reason why we don't succeed in relationships is because we interact with every person the exact same way. And it's not working for us. And the way that you're relating to people in your life, I mean, this is overly simplistic, it's either working or not working. And COVID, for all of us this season, has put a ton of strain on our relationships. It's put a lot of pressure. So we want to evaluate, how do we succeed in the different areas of our relationships? We're going to look at four different types of relationships. One, relationship with God. And these are going to be the 4 weeks of the series. We're going to talk about relationship with God. We're going to look at relationship with yourself. There is a way that you see you. And the way you see you is influencing all of your relationships. In the third week, we're going to talk about relationship with others. And then in the fourth and final week, I'm very excited about this message. We're going to talk about your relationship with your work. We're going to talk about how you think about what happens from 9 to 5 or 9 to midnight, whatever your work schedule is, but your work throughout the course of your life, that the intersection of faith and work is so incredibly important. Now, for our message today, I want to start focusing on your relationship with God, because your relationship with God is the most important aspect of your life. I know that there are a lot of different types of people that come to our church. There are some of you that grew up in a Catholic family and you were forced to go to church every weekend. Others of you, maybe you explored lots of different world religions. Some of you, maybe you grew up in a world religion on the other side of the world, and you grew up in a Hindu family or a Buddhist family, and this whole thing about Christianity and following Jesus is a new thing to you. Regardless of what your background is, you have a view of God. Even if you are a militant atheist, there is a view of God that you have, and that view of God is influencing so many aspects of your life. It kind of reminds me of a conversation I had with a friend earlier this year. So one time earlier this year, I had a friend reach out. He wanted to grab lunch together, so he called and set up an appointment, and we sat down for a meal with each other. We went to my favorite restaurant called True Food Kitchen. I'm always looking for an opportunity to go to True Food Kitchen. And when we got there, we had a great conversation. You know, the water came, the food came, appetizers. And throughout the course of the meal, I got to know this guy. We had been acquaintances up until this point. And I just started asking him questions about his family and his job and his faith. It was a great meal. And at the end of the meal, when dessert came, he looks at me and he says, "Hey, Andy, you're way more approachable than I thought you would be." Now, part of the reason why this struck me is because, you know, I think sometimes I do have different versions of my personality. It's not so much that I'm a different person. It's just like sometimes I'm intense, I'm focused. Other times I'm playful, I'm relational. But this was the first time this guy had ever seen that side of me in this conversation. And that view of me influenced the way he related to me. It influenced the whole conversation. Now, thank God, now he sees me differently. And it made me begin to think about our view of others in relationships, how the way that we view people really does play into how we relate to one another. And it's important for us, when it comes to God, to recognize your view of God determines your approach to God. If you don't hear anything else I say today, I want to encourage you, write that down. If you like to tweet or you like to Instagram, you can put that on at Echo Church Live or at Pastor Andy Wood. Let somebody mark it, that this quote is so important because it plays in to every aspect of your life. There is a view of God that you carry with you, and that view of God is not always accurate. And that view that you have of who God and what He is who God is and what He is like is influencing the way you relate to Him, the way you see yourself, the way you see the people in your life, and the way you go about your work. So today, I want to help you understand how to view God the way God wants to be viewed. We're going to go to a very beautiful passage of scripture in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. I want to encourage you, if you have a Bible, you can pull it out or you can just watch on the screen as we go through. And we're going to look at this letter that was written by John. Now, it's important to recognize John is one of the early followers of Jesus. There were 12 people that followed Jesus for 3 years. I mean, this guy spent so much time with Jesus. He was a part of the inner circle of three, and then he was the one that Jesus loved. It was noted that John was the disciple or the follower whom Jesus loved. Now, you have to recognize John said that about himself. And he understood so much about Jesus. He probably even knew what Jesus's breath smelled like. He was there when Jesus was crucified. He was the only disciple or follower of Jesus that didn't leave when Jesus was crucified. And he was one of the first ones that saw Jesus after Jesus resurrected from the dead. This guy loved Jesus. His whole life was committed to him. After the resurrection, this guy went out and told people about Jesus. He wrote a book of the Bible called John. It's a great book if you're exploring faith. And when he was old, he was sentenced to this island called Patmos. And he was there in isolation. He was imprisoned there for his faith in Jesus. And while he was there, he got a revelation from God. It's known as the Book of Revelation. And it's a revelation of the end times. It's a very fascinating book. At the beginning of the book, there were seven letters that John wrote. One of those letters was a vision. In fact, it was Jesus showing up to the seven churches that he wanted John to write down seven letters to seven different churches. And it made me think about this. Like, if you go and you read these first three chapters of John, you'll see these seven letters. If Jesus were to write a letter to us in San Jose, what the letter would say, or to us in Fremont or South San Jose or Sunnyvale, what would the letter say? Now, this letter in particular was written to the church in Laodicea. And in the letter, Jesus makes some very important things he wants John to communicate to the church. He says, to the church in Laodicea, you're lukewarm. Maybe you've heard this verse before. Jesus said, you're not hot or cold. You're not on fire or you're not refreshing for me to be around. In fact, it's so pitiful that I want to spit you out of my mouth. I know it's a lot to take in. But then Jesus changes his tone towards the end of that letter to the church in Laodicea. And he says to them in chapter 3 of verse 20, I want you to hear his words, because these are the words that Jesus wants himself to be viewed through. And John understanding and believing that Jesus was not just a great teacher or miracle worker, believing that Jesus was God himself, would write these words as Jesus communicated them to us and to the church at Laodicea through John. Revelation chapter 3, Jesus makes a statement. He says, look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends. Jesus gives this beautiful image of him standing on the other side of the door, knocking, wanting to come in. It kind of reminds me of my kids. I got to come up here for this because this is just like crazy story I got to tell y'all. So it reminds me of my kids, and I have three of them. 13, 11, 6. And my kids really struggle with boundaries. If, you know, your kids are in the room, maybe you guys can talk about boundaries a little bit. My kids follow my wife everywhere. And it kind of bothers me sometimes because there are points at which I want to be alone with her. I want to have time with her. In fact, there are times where I want to be alone myself. And so she's like a little duck. She's like a duck with a bunch of ducklings following her everywhere. And it was cool, like when they were, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 years old. But now they're, you know, 13, 11, and 6. Sometimes it's annoying. Like when I'm taking a shower and there are three kids in the room, it's like, no, I need some space, y'all. And one of the things that my kids have a hard time with is doors. Like they don't respect doors. So you close the door and they just barge in the door. In fact, it was a real problem. The house we live in, when we first moved in, there was no lock on our door that Stacy and I stay in. And that really affected things, if you know what I'm saying. Stacy, she didn't like the fact that there was no lock on the door. And when the kids went to bed and there was no lock on the door, that meant that we just went straight to bed. You know what I'm saying? So This lasted for about a week. I got a lock on the door, and I was not going to live for a long period of time. But every so often, I still forget to lock the door. So one night, I had gone through my whole nightly routine, and I laid down, I rolled over, I'm about to fall asleep. And right before I fall asleep, I turn back over to face the outside of the bed. And when I turn over to face the outside of the bed, there is a full-grown man at the edge of my bed. And I have a metal pipe underneath my bed. And just as I'm about to reach down to grab the metal pipe, I hear a voice, "Dad, I can't fall asleep. Can I have a melatonin?" I'm like, "Bro, knock on the door. There is a door for a reason. You can knock before you come in." Jesus respects our boundaries. He gives you a will. He wired you in such a way. He's a gentleman. He doesn't barge in. In fact, this passage shows us, Jesus says, "I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone will open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends." I hope today that you can realize, maybe for the very first time, that Jesus desires a friendship with you. Jesus wants to be your friend. Y'all, this is good news. I don't know what your perspective of God has been like up until this point, but when we understand, put that point back up for just a second, Jesus wants to be your friend. Jesus wants to have a relationship with you that is more than a relationship of an acquaintance. In fact, I want you to write this down too. A friend is different than an acquaintance. I mean, think about people in your life that you have an acquaintance relationship with. You call them on the phone. Maybe you have an appointment with work, a Zoom call. And there are all these pleasantries that you have to get through. But then there are some people in your life, friends, like my good friend Ryan. We've been friends since we were 12 years old. We were college roommates. He knows all my junk. And when I call him on the phone, oftentimes we're straight into it. He'll send a text. I send a text. "Man, I'm struggling. I need your help." That's different than an acquaintance. And the kind of relationship that God wants to have with you, Jesus wants to have with you, is one where he comes in and he shares a meal together as friends. A friend is different than an acquaintance. Many of us have this view of God that he stands off in the distance, that he does not want to be close, that he is unapproachable. And that view of God is shaping your approach to God. Perhaps even for you today, your view of God is not that he's an acquaintance, but that he's a critic. And I want you to see, even today from this story, that a friend is different than a critic. And I'm actually a little bit surprised even right now how much criticism there is flying around in our culture. So much criticism on social media. In fact, I actually thought on social media, especially on Facebook, when you click on that button that says friends, that you become friends. That's why a few weeks ago I was surprised when somebody saw a picture of my kids with face masks on and called me an abuser of my children. So then I just looked at it. I'm like, well, we're probably not friends. So I clicked a button. I think it's called defriend. Anybody have somebody you need to defriend on Facebook or social media? But isn't it interesting that oftentimes we think of God like that? Like God's waiting for you to make a post or do something, and everything that you do, he's a critic and he's trying to. Jesus is not a critic of yours. Jesus is for you. There is no one who is for you more than Jesus. He loves you and he wants a friendship. If anyone would open the door, the scripture says, Jesus is saying these words to you. If you would open the door, I stand at the door and knock. And if you will, I'll come in and we'll share a meal together as one shares with their friends. Now, that brings up a very important question. What does Jesus want from a friendship with us? I'm so glad you asked that question. That question fuels the way that we should think about God. We're going to look in particular at what Jesus says about the kind of friendship that he wants with us. If you go to Matthew chapter 22, or it'll also be here on the screen, in Matthew chapter 22, Jesus actually will comment about the type of friendship that he wants to have with you, the type of relationship that he wants to have. Now, it's interesting, even in this passage of scripture, a religious leader is questioning Jesus about relationship with God, and he comes up with this question. He says to him in verse 35, an expert in the religious law tried to trap him and ask this question, "Teacher, which is the most important commandment in all the law of Moses?" Now, there are 600 plus laws in Moses' law, and Jesus is like being pressed. Which one is the most important? And watch Jesus' response. Jesus replied, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind." That at the end of the day, all of the law and all of the commandments, Jesus says, boils down to this: love God with everything that you are. And then he says this, the second is like this, equally important, love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Recently, I was in a meeting with a group of people, and there was a pastor, and there was this one guy in his church, and he was accusing the pastor of not being deep enough in his teaching, and he was really frustrated with this pastor. It wasn't me, by the way, just in case you're wondering, I'm not speaking in third person. But I was watching this whole scenario play out, and he's literally yelling in the pastor's face. And what struck me is that he missed the whole point of following Jesus. This guy's like screaming in his pastor's face. I'm like, how in the world is that love? And he wants something deeper. He's asking for a deeper theology, a deeper belief. Y'all, this is really deep right here. I mean, you could spend your whole life thinking about this, that everything in God's laws and his commandments and everything that Jesus taught points back to loving God and loving people. And isn't it beautiful that Jesus would make everything about love? That's the second point that I want you to write down, is that love is the goal of the relationship. That's the kind of friendship that God wants to have with you. It's one of friendship. It's one of relationship because of love. It's not something you have to do. It's something that you're invited to based upon his knocking on the door of your heart. I want you to understand that this is why groups are so important. This is why today, one of the most important decisions that you can make is to get into community with other people. By clicking on the link as it shows up here today, you can find out more about all the different types of groups that we have. But there's something so potent and beautiful when you get in a community of people that are striving to love God and love each other. It gives you the strength to live this kind of life that God has created you to live. And the longer you follow Jesus, the more he wants to bring you back and me back. To love is what it's all about. Now, love is challenging, and love calls us to higher standards. But at the end of the day, if it's not about love, it's not about loving God and loving people, then we've missed the whole point of Jesus' teachings. See, love is very different than the law. This is where people in Jesus' day got really confused. They thought that the outward appearance of understanding and memorizing and obeying all the laws was the thing that communicated that they were a religious person. But what law does is oftentimes the law is like a guilty obligation to do the right thing versus actually doing something from the inside. See, the law tends to oppress people when love has this way of liberating and motivating people. It's kind of like these dishes. Like if at the end of this meal, these dishes all had to be cleaned up. When I was in high school, my parents would make me wash the dishes, and I hated it. I would loathe it every night. I know my kids hate it as well, based on their responses, right, guys? You don't like it very much. And at the same time, I'm not backing off of my standard. I'm just saying I hated it, and they hate it, because you have to. When you don't have a choice in the matter, it causes us internally to be frustrated. But there's a big difference when you get to. So now that I'm married, I've been married to Stacy for 17 and a half years. She loves when I wash the dishes. So guess what? Now I love to wash the dishes because I love Stacy. When I understand that God is a God of love that has demonstrated his love for me. And the kind of friendship that he wants to have with me, it inspires me and motivates me. I love this verse from 1 John chapter 4. And I want you to see this with me. John is also speaking here, and he's writing a letter, and he said, God showed us how much he loved us by sending his one and only son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. That's how much God loves you, that he would take your place, my place, on a cross so that we could be forgiven. And the more that we understand the price that Jesus paid when he was hung on a Roman cross, the more we are inspired and liberated to love God back and to love other people. Love's the goal of the friendship. It all connects back to the goal of love. In 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1, the Apostle Paul, the early follower of Jesus, wrote, let love be your highest goal. Let it be the aim, the focus of your life. So when you love somebody, you want to please them. You want to do the things that they care about and they value. And that leads to this final point. But before I share this final point with you, I want to share one more story with you. So recently during COVID, our relationships have been impacted in our family. I know that it's been harder for so many of us. It's harder for those of you who are students and you want to be back at your classes and hang out with your friends. I know for us as a church, it's challenging because so many of us look forward to that moment that we're together physically, and there's so much coming at us in terms of information and politics and things that are confusing us, and we don't know what to believe anymore. And this ultimately is impacting our relationships. I mean, even if you really love somebody and care about them, if you're stuck in the same house with them 24/7, it's going to affect your relationship with them. And so we actually, earlier on in COVID, as we were struggling, we heard about this lady. She's a therapist, and she excels at family systems. That's her therapy style. And so we would hop onto Zooms with her actually every other week, and we would just talk through our challenges as a family. So one of the areas that we started to focus on was mealtime. And as you can see, we have some plates here, and it reminded me of mealtime. And she wanted to diagnose our problems, because every time we sit down, y'all, I don't know what it's like in your family, but in my family, there's almost always a fight at the dinner table. It doesn't matter what the food is. It doesn't matter what we did before that or after that. There's almost always a fight. So she asked me a question. She said, well, tell me more about the arrangement of the table. And so I said, well, you know, I actually like drew it on a little piece of paper and showed it on Zoom. Like, well, my daughter sits here, my son sits here. And she said, well, what if you change the places? And I'm like, I am not paying this woman $200 an hour to tell me where to put my kids at the table. That is the dumbest thing ever. But I'm humble, and so I listened to her. So we changed the places, and when we changed the places, the next day when we sat at the table, there were no fights. And I'm like, it can't be that simple. So, you know, we switched it back, and then there were fights. And then next time we switched it back, and there were no fights. I'm like, it can't be that simple as the arrangement at the table. Now, my kids, when they get really close, they still fight. But the arrangement made all the difference in the world. And I want us to see, as we wrap up our time together, that arrangement of the table matters. And this is the point, that first place at the table matters. And many of us, we have the kind of relationship with God where we have invited him to the table, but we've put him at the wrong seat. In fact, we're letting Jesus not sit at the head of the table. We're at the head of the table, and we feel like we're the ones that get to tell Jesus what to do. When in reality, the kind of relationship that God wants to have with you is one where he leads, he guides, he directs your life. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, I want to wrap up on these couple of verses, and I want to speak to two different types of people. There are some of you that you are here today and you are exploring what you believe about Jesus. You're processing. And one of the key places that you can continue to process is in a group that we have called Alpha. Alpha is a place where you can get together with people who are wrestling through what they believe about God. We wrestle through life's deep questions, and then we watch a video together. It's a great group. You'll see a place where you can sign up even today to be a part of that conversation. And there are some of you who are exploring faith, and you're here today, and you're hearing all of this about Jesus. Maybe even you grew up in a religious background, but you didn't have the right belief about God, and you're for the very first time realizing how much God loves you and how much God wants a relationship with you. And today can be the very first day that you put your trust in Jesus, that when Jesus died on a cross and he hung there and his blood was spilled, he paid for your sin so that you can be forgiven and your relationship with God can begin. There's power in that realization that he died in your place so that all of your jealousy and all the moments of selfishness that have ever happened in your heart and all the choices that you've made sexually that you deeply regret and all the things that we have done, we all have those moments in our lives, that sin that separates us from God. The death of Jesus on a cross is the payment so we can be restored back to the heart of God. And Jesus's resurrection for us is the proof that he is God, that he conquered the grave, and he's still alive today, and he is knocking on the door of your heart, wanting relationship to begin right now in this moment. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10 says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. Belief in your heart, confess with your mouth that he is Lord. Relationship between you and God can begin right now in this moment. I want to invite you to take that step today, to open the door and let Jesus in and welcome him to the table. If that's you, God's stirring in your heart right now in this moment, you can make that decision in your heart to pray this prayer before God, to say, Jesus, if this is you, pray it right now. Jesus, I believe that you died on a cross for my sins. I believe that you conquered the grave. I want to yield control of my life to you. I invite you to the table. I'm surrendering everything I am to you. Please forgive me for my past. Please wipe the slate clean. By faith, I trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you just made that decision, you made the most important decision you'll ever make, and I want to encourage you, click on that button right there that says, I made a decision to follow Jesus. We have some resources. We'd love to help you. We'd love to help you get connected to a group and begin your journey spiritually. Now, others of you, I want to talk to those of you who Jesus is at the table, but he's at the wrong seat, and you've been running on doing your life the way you want to do it. And today, I want to remind you of this verse. Maybe some of you have heard this verse before. In Romans chapter 14, verse 9, it says, Christ died and rose again for this very purpose, to be Lord of both the living and the dead. What that verse means is that he wants to be in first place in your life. And when you open your heart to him, he gets to decide. He gets to decide what you do with your money. He gets to decide what you do with your sexuality. He gets to decide about what you do with your words. And what happens over time is people will decide to follow Jesus, but they get off. I get off. You get off. And there is this fresh invitation to come back to him. The Bible uses the word repentance or confession to recognize that when we see our sin, we turn back to God. And if there's anything I've learned in 25 plus years of following Jesus, life works best when we listen to and obey Jesus. And there's some things in your life, perhaps right now, that you have not been listening to God on. And the deepest regrets in our lives come from the moments when God invited us, stirred in us, called us to action, to obedience, and we chose to go our own way. Today, I want to encourage you to take that step, to let him be master. That word Lord means he's in charge. He gets to decide. He conquered the grave. He paid for your sin and my sin. He wiped the slate clean. He forgave us. He deposited his spirit into our life. He's given us everything that we need to live the life that he's called us to live. And now he gets to decide what we do with our lives. And I want to invite you today to just turn back to him. Maybe there's an area of your life that you need to repent of, that you need to say, I'm sorry, God. I'm sorry for the thing I've made it, and I come back to you today. I come back to center. As you're making this decision, I want to encourage you to write down somewhere what that decision is. Maybe there's somebody that needs to break up with a friend, that with somebody you've been dating. Maybe you need to stop living with your boyfriend. Today's that day that you decide, God, I'm choosing to honor you with my sexual purity. Some of you today, you've been lying, and it's to say, God, I want my words to be honest before you. Others of you, it's to start trusting God with your finances and your resources. If you click on that check-in button, let us know how we can help you. And one of the best steps that you can take today is to get connected into community. Today, you can make that decision. Click on the check-in button. You'll see a place where you can get more info on groups, and we would love to resource you. As we wrap up our time together today, one of those areas, again, that a lot of times we hold back on God is our finances. And I want to encourage you, when you trust in God with every aspect of your life, you invite him to the table. He can bless every aspect of who you are. And even your finances work best when you invite him to be in charge. Today, you can take that step. Just click on that link, echo.church/giving, and you can join us in your generosity to make a difference and be a part of what God is doing in this community. I do want to say thank you for your continued generosity. God has used you in so many ways to accomplish his mission here through our church. And as you give today, we give with joyful hearts, knowing that God is using our lives to make a massive impact on the community around us. Now, be sure to join us next week as we continue our series. We're going to look at this idea of loving yourself. Your view of yourself is impacting the way that you treat other people. And many people struggle relationally because they have the wrong view of themselves. We're going to talk about how your view of God plays into your view of yourself. We'll see you back next week. Let's go back to the campus hosts as they wrap up our time together.
Hey everybody, welcome to the post-game analysis here. You've got Stephen and Tim. I mean, what a performance out there today. Tim, what are your thoughts?
I mean, I would say it was beyond a performance, really. It was heavenly. Yeah. Pastor Andy really brought it home on this message today. And the thing that really stood out to me is really in the midst of us balancing all these relationships and priority, what matters most is who's in first place. And maybe some of you today, you made that decision to make God number one, to make him first in your life. You've made that decision to say yes to following Jesus. And we want to know. Make sure to check in with us and check that box. Follow the links that are there on your screens. And we want to be able to support you, to cheer you on, to send you resources, welcoming you a part of the team to make sure that you're walked alongside in this journey of faith. Now, Pastor Andy also talked about some key points of what we can do in this season when it comes to relationship. What was that?
We recognize that nobody's going to be winning a championship on their own. It is a team effort. And so the best way that we all can do that is by joining one of our Echo groups. They're launching this week. It's not too late to make sure that you get your spot on a team. You just have to go to echo.church/groups to sign up. No matter what season of life you're in, there is a community ready and waiting for you, and you all can work together to bring the ball down the field. So, Tim, as we wrap up, what are some of those closing thoughts you have?
Yeah, well, it's only going to get more exciting from here because next week, it is week 2 of the Relationship Playbook. And if you found today helpful, encouraging, or fun, make sure to bring a friend along with you because it's going to be a memorable experience you're not going to want to miss. We're going to be tackling a subject that our friend Stephen here is all too familiar with, and it is relationship with yourself.
Yep, I've been working on that for years.
That's awesome. Well, we're excited for it. We'll see you again next week. Make sure to tune in.
Awesome. Signing off. Man, so how do you...